So in the challenge of using pictures on a blog or a website, two different challenges. First of all, finding the picture and making sure it's of good quality, of course, it's appropriate, but also finding the copyright and tracing back the copyright, which very often sounds simpler than it really is. A second aspect, and even if you found the right pictures, very often I found that people have challenges in processing and editing those pictures to make sure that they show properly on their website, but also they don't slow down the website. So in this webinar, we have the three different parts, finding the pictures, processing the pictures, and in the middle, we'll have an interludium on more the technical aspect to give a little bit of an explanation of how pictures are actually stored and displayed. If you understand that, then you will also understand how why it is so important that we compress pictures and crop it to the right size before we upload it to our websites and to our blog. So in the chapter of finding pictures, where do we find pictures? Well, first of course, you have your own pictures, or you have your organization's library. You might also find pictures on the related websites, you might know. And the tool that I use most is I go and do a Google image search. I try to find a picture on Flickr, which is still the largest online repository we have. Or I go to some freeware sites, sites that do nothing else but publishing pictures that are free for everybody to use. Marina, next. Thank you. So let's tackle first finding pictures via Google or using pictures from known websites together, as both have really related issues. Well, finding pictures via Google in principle is very simple. You Google the topic using keywords, and you click on images where you have a plethora of pictures being presented to you. Like here in this example on the screen, we did a Google search for pearl millet, and we find pictures on pearl millet. Now, if the problem is, however, if how to find a picture that is not copyrighted, and this is one of the key issues I want to highlight during this webinar, is it's all fine, we can find thousands of pictures online, but it is very difficult to trace back the copyright. So, and in the past, several times, mea culpa, I've come across occasions where I used a picture only to find afterwards there was actually a copyright conflict. So over the years, I have become rather conservative in which pictures I use. I have to be absolutely sure I don't infringe a copyright, which is easier said than done. So here, with this typical Google search, a search for the keywords pearl millet, how can Google help us to find pictures which we are allowed to reuse? Marina, can you mute your microphone for a moment, please? Thank you. Next slide, please. So after this search, now I have your video again. Well, wait. Can you bring the presentation back up again? Yeah. There we go. So after we searched for that with the keywords, we found ourselves in the image window. And if you look at the screen, there is one Dropbox which says usage rights. If we click on that, we actually have different options. And we can do a search, a filter, based on different copyright rights. So you can filter the images which are labeled for reuse. This means that we can reuse them. And often with certain conditions. Most nonprofit websites allow us to reuse them for non-commercial purposes. This means on your own nonprofit website. And most of them allow reuse with modification, which means that you can recrop them, for instance. But even if Google is really good in identifying reusable pictures, I'm on the next slide, Marina. Even if Google is pretty good in trying to identify pictures we can reuse, it is always good that we look at the picture itself to make sure that we can reuse them without running the risk of infringing and copyright. For instance, next slide, Marina. Say that this is a picture that we found through the Google search, a picture from GFAR.net. And this picture looks appropriate for us. It's a picture about a farmer holding a crop, some pearl millet in his hands. Now, this picture might look appropriate, but how can we reuse it? Next slide. Well, the first thing that we do is to check the copyright notice on the website itself. Does the website allow us to reuse its material? Here is an example of the footer on GFAR.net, which clearly states that you can reuse the material on the website. It is a little bit more complicated because there is an additional note that says, if some material was aggregated from other sites, you need to use the copyright from that originating site. And a side remark here, do check your websites and blogs. Do you actually have a clear copyright notice? In my experience, about half of the websites that I visit do not, or it's not clear where to find the copyright notice. By the way, in my view, material from most of our sites, as we are nonprofit organizations, should, according to me, have at least a reuse with attribution copyright. As we are publicly funded, the material that we generate, including our pictures, should be usable and reusable by the public. So I do encourage you to encourage people to reuse your material, but with a clear attribution to your originating site, to your site. This is also a good way to propagate your content. After all, this is what social media is all about, socializing your material. And you can use a Creative Commons copyright notice. Creative Commons is a collaborative copyright scheme with different conditions for what purpose people can reuse your material, commercial, non-commercial, is attribution needed, are modifications allowed, et cetera, et cetera. But then, going back to the site where we found the picture, very often we come into a problem. Many sites use pictures which are not theirs. So maybe they have the permission to use that picture, which doesn't mean that we can use the picture that they have on their website. So the second thing that I do, when I found an appropriate picture and looked at the copyright on the webpage itself where I found it, I also look at the attribution. In the blog post or on the webpage is an attribution for the picture. Does it refer to another site? If so, I go and look on that site to see what the copyright notice is on the original site. So it becomes a quest trying to find a treasure hunt, trying to find where does that picture originally comes from. If you're lucky, you will find a site which has a clear attribution to where they found the picture with a link. So then it would be easy to trace it back. But very often people make an attribution just by giving a name of the photographer or the name of the generic website of the source where they found it, but not actually on which web page that you found it. So we have a challenge here. Apart from the fact that many sites fail to give a proper attribution or copyright notice, we often find pictures on the websites which are not owned by that organization. So how do we trace back to where the original picture came from? The treasure hunt. Next slide, Marina. So for that, we use something that we call reverse image search. Again, something that Google makes it very easy for us to do. Google not only allows you to search for pictures through keyword searches, like we did pearl millet in the past example, but actually Google is also pretty good in finding pictures by the means of using pictures. In other words, you can tell Google, find me all sites where this particular picture has been used. And this particular picture, how do we tell Google what picture we want to search for? Well, to do that, you go to the Google image search again, as you see on the screen. But you see on the right-hand side of the search bar, you have a little camera icon. So you click on that camera icon in the search bar, and then you get the next screen. Next one, Marina. Very good. You can now search by image. So here, Google is not asking for the keywords. Google is asking us to upload an image or to paste an image URL, the web address of that image. So of course, if you have the image already on your hard drive, you can upload it and do a search, or you can use the picture URL. If you're still scouting around for pictures, you have to try to get the picture URL, the web address of that particular picture. Next slide, Marina. So how, in our example, the guy with the pearl millet, how do we find the picture URL? Well, for any picture on any website, on any browser, you can right-click while hovering over the picture, and you will get a small drop-down window, drop-down box, it will show you a number of options, one of them being copy image location. The terminology might depend a little bit on your browser. So the image location is the URL of the picture. So if you do copy image location, next slide, Marina, and you paste that into the search, the image, the reverse image search box, and you hit search by image, you will get all of the websites, next slide, all of the websites where you can find that particular image. So in here, and this is pretty powerful, as with Google Image Search, it even includes variations of the same pictures. For instance, other websites that have cropped the original, compressed it, or edited, it will list all of the websites. So here in this example, you will see that this particular picture was used on three sites. One of them is the GFAR blog, one of them is a website from the Yale University, and one of them is some Russian site. Now, by the way, this is also an interesting tool if you are a photographer or if you are an organization with a picture library. This allows you to search where some of your good pictures have been used. And you will be amazed what you found. Some of the pictures that I took, and I know have been used on other websites, if I trace them with the reverse image search, I found back dozens of sites where these pictures are useful. And if you're somewhere, you have a sleepless night, do it as an exercise. It is interesting also to see how the people have actually given attribution to me or wrongly gave attributions to a site that used my picture without wrong attribution. So this comes back again to our treasure hunt in trying to find the original picture, the site of the owner of the picture. So if there is any possibility to try and trace back where the original picture came from, it must be amongst these sites that we found in the Google reverse image site. So this is searching by via Google or trying to trace back via Google where the original picture came from when we found a picture on a website. Next slide, Marina. Next one. Very good. The next, if I don't find anything on Google, I don't find anything on a website that I know, the next step for me would be to have a look on Flickr. Flickr is definitely one of the most extensive online photo repositories. So how do you search for a picture on Flickr? Well, you enter in the key bar, you enter in the search bar, you enter the keywords. I enter Pearl Millet again, and I click on search photos. Next one, Marina. Flickr then lists all of the pictures it has found with that particular keyword or keywords, either in the title or in the description. Now, we have the same challenge again now as what we had with the Google image search. It doesn't mean that those pictures can be reused. Now, to filter out in Flickr all of the pictures that can be reused, you simply click on the drop-down box, any license, and you select all Creative Commons. This will then list all of the pictures that are labeled in Flickr for reuse. Next one, Marina. Yep. So if I clicked on one of those pictures I found with the Creative Commons license, look again on that individual picture. Look at, on the right-hand side, what copyright license it gives. So this one is actually a picture from Ikrisat, and it clearly shows that it can be used for non-commercial purposes. It can be reused, but with attribution. And in here, I would like to make a remark. How does Flickr actually find those pictures? Well, they can only find the keywords if they found those in your title or description. So unless if your picture has a proper title and description, there is no way Flickr can point searches to your photo. And similarly also, there is no way that Google can actually find your photo unless if you use certain keywords or describe the right topic in your title or description. So here is a golden tip. If you just stay there, Marina. So if you upload pictures, and this also goes for videos, slides, and podcasts, do take the time to give those resources, those pictures, videos, slides, and podcasts a proper title and a proper description, because that is the only way that Google or the repository that you use can actually use find your pictures. But also, please do make it easy for people to reuse your pictures. So make sure that your copyright is clear. So the next thing after this webinar everybody has to do is, first of all, look if on their website the copyright notice is clear and it's actually a shareable attributions copyright. But also have a look at your Flickr libraries. Is it clear for every single picture what copyright is used for those pictures? And in Flickr it's easy. You can, for all of your pictures, in almost two clicks, you can put your copyright as shareable. And if need be, if you want specific attributions, put those into your description. So how do you want people to attribute the picture? Do you want it with the link? Do you want the organization name to be mentioned? Do you want the photographer's name to be mentioned, et cetera, et cetera? Let's look at another example. Next slide, Marina. This is a zoom of a picture that I found on Flickr. So it is only the part of the description and the copyright, the bottom part of the picture page. So as you can see, this picture clearly has a title. In this case, it gives the location. It has a bit of text explaining what this picture is all about, of course, with including the needed keywords. And in the description, it also details the attribution people need to use. In this case, at the bottom of the description, it says photo picasier/CCAF. This is the attribution that they expect. On the right, you see the top right, you see the clear copyright notice. It can be reused for non-commercial purposes on condition of attribution. But they did even better. They geotagged the picture in Flickr, so it can easily be found by location on a map. And as a final note, again, less to do with how to find pictures, but a lot to do with picture libraries. Please look at the bottom, at the very bottom on the left-hand side of the description field. In here, CCAFS has added the link. It has less to do with searching pictures, but still important when we talk about uploading pictures. Please include the link where people can read more about the topic of this picture. And this is the same when we use pictures or videos or podcasts or slides. When we upload them on that resource, please include a link so people, if they found that particular slide or video or picture, people know how to read more about this topic. So back again to finding pictures. Next slide. Thank you, Marina. We found pictures on websites. It might be random websites via a Google search. We found pictures on Flickr. In the end, still, there are some freeware photo sites. These are free online resources listing shareware or freeware photos. The most popular are probably Pixabay or Pexels. Even though for our purpose, I found that these might be pictures which are good for generic use, but specialized or specific pictures are very difficult to find. For instance, I would not find a picture with pearl minutes on these sites. Still, I use them as, you know, sometimes when I write about abstract topics, let's say I write a blog post about the Green Revolution, I might use a more generic picture in my blog post. For instance, a close-up picture of a green leaf. These generic pictures are typically pictures I would be able to find on freeware photo sites. The interesting thing is in there, all the pictures there are copyright free. Very often they don't even need an attribution. So I don't have to do all of this treasure hunt, trying to find back who is the original owner of those pictures if I don't find attributions on the websites I've found. So if you use other freeware photo sites, you can list them in the chat box. All right, this is the time, Marina, that we'll have a look at the questions that came in. You can switch on your... yeah, there we have Marina back again. Hi, Marina.
Thanks.
I hear you.
So yeah, as Peter suggested, if you have any questions, it's the time to put them in the chat box. NJRA says, wanted to post this to ask question, but I can't. What's the role of tags in Flickr if the search only scores descriptions and titles?
Yeah, tags, are only useful if people search for tags. And Mike, this is very much how we used to do searches with Google keywords. Now Google doesn't use tags anymore as its keywords. So in my experience, I almost never use tags anymore, neither in videos, neither in pictures, neither in blog posts, because less and less search engines use the tags as a search criteria.
Does it respond to your question, Jerry? You can leave a comment otherwise. EpiFan says, how to establish a picture library for my organization?
A picture library for your organization, my immediate tip would be to use an online repository such as Flickr. Flickr now provides gigantic storage capacity for a very limited price. It allows you to organize your pictures in different folders, give proper titles and descriptions. So for me, the one and only online photo library that you should use would be Flickr. It used to be Picasa by Google, but Picasa is no longer available. So Flickr, definitely.
Mahesh asks also, can we manipulate, crop, for example, the pictures taken from other sources, or do we have to use them as they are?
Yeah, it depends on the copyright notice. Typically, when people say allow reuse for non-commercial purpose with attribution, you're allowed to modify them. There are some instances where people use a copyright notice which clearly states that modifications are not allowed. Very often these are professional pictures by professional photographers, and most of the time they do not allow their picture to be integrated in other pictures. That's what they mean by modification. So in principle, I do not hesitate to crop a picture to take show a more a detailed view, as long as I make a proper attribution. I never run into problems using that. What I do avoid, though, is integrating, for instance, two pictures I found on other websites and photoshopping them into one picture. That generally people don't like, and it is typically what people ask to avoid with the non-modification copyright notice.
Great. Branwen asked, so if a picture is copyright free, this automatically means no attribution is needed on your website, blog?
No, when it's copyright, well, it depends. Copyright free, if it is on the freeware, very often they do not ask for an attribution. When you look on those freeware sites, such as Pixabay, very often you will see in the picture itself, in the description, it says attribution not required. Still, being social in the social media, I always attribute. And where possible, I attribute with a link. This is, I think, a common courtesy. So I would not be picky on how you attribute where you found the pictures from. In the end, you're using material that you found somewhere, or material you used from somebody, so I give them all of the attribution where needed. Even if they don't ask for me to link back to their site, I still put a link in the picture attribution. So I think it's common courtesy. I would always give an attribution.
Thanks. Before I move on with the three next questions, I know some of you do see the screen as very blurred. Very sorry for that. And some of you also missed some part of the presentation due to poor connectivity. Do know that we would share the PowerPoint afterwards, right, Peter?
Yeah, we'll share the PowerPoint as well as the recording of the webinar itself.
Okay, let's move on with the next question. Benga asks, when you modify a picture, do you state in the attribution that the picture is modified or adapted?
You can, but you don't have to. Generally, I don't do this. Generally, I try to use the attribution as they have specified, the name of the photographer, the website I found it on, eventually the name of the organization, but that's how I keep it.
Okay, and Vivek asks, how to know that pictures that I have taken is used without crediting me?
Yeah, this is going back again to the reversed image search. As we've covered, with the Google image search, you can upload one of your pictures in the search bar itself, and then say, find me all of the sites that have used your picture. However, in that functionality, Google does not have an option to say, do look for those sites that used that particular picture, but have not attributed. You will have to go through the sites manually and see if they have given proper attribution.
Right, and I think that's also a response to Zainal's questions, which was, yeah, how do I know who are using the pictures I took? I guess that's the same process, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
And Epiphane asked, what's the most common penalty for copyright infringement? That's really new to me.
Well, it depends. Marina, do you want to share your story?
Well, it doesn't respond what's the copyright infringement. I don't know. No, tell us about it.
Well, once upon a time, there was this person that I knew who has a website which publishes posts from a community. So people, part of the community, would be able to submit blog posts. So one of the blog posts was submitted with a picture which had a reference to a certain site. And we had the problem that I mentioned before, is that particular certain site used that picture without properly attributing it to the originator. So we didn't really find where that picture came from. So we put it on our website, attributing the site where we found it, who actually infringed copyright. So somehow the owner of that picture found back that on my friend's community website, the picture was used. And we got an email through the contact us link on our website saying that we would have to pay, since the date that the post was published, X amount of dollars. And the post was already online since a while, so it cost us quite a bit of money. I've had once upon a time on my personal blog a couple of years ago, I used a picture, again, that I did not properly trace back to the owner. The owner found it and sent me an email claiming quite a few dollars. So when you infringe on copyright, you never really know if the owner will find out. But very often, if they do find out, and particularly when they come from North America, they very often would claim quite a bit of money. This is one thing. Secondly, when you infringe copyright, it is possible to notify Google that your site has copyright infringement, so they should exclude your site, or at least the page on which the copyright infringement is, from the search. And once that mechanism is set in motion, it can be really negative, where your search traffic really comes down. So that's why I stress in this first part, I put so much stress and emphasis on trying to find back where the original picture comes from. My general rule is, if you are not 110% sure where this picture comes from, don't use it. Marina?
Good, thanks. Mahesh asked a very good question, actually. If we have hired a photographer to shoot for us, do we have to credit him?
Very good question, Mahesh. This depends on the contract that you have with the photographer. Most of the time, you have to agree. Well, let's say most of the time, I would encourage you to agree with the photographer. If you hire a professional photographer, how credits to the photo should be done. Also agree with the photographer where the pictures can be stored. Because some photographers want to use a selection of the pictures they took for you on their contract for you, paid by you, on a project paid by you. They also want to include them on his or her own website. So agree on those two aspects. The attributions, if it should only go to the organization or to the photographer and the organization. If indeed the person is hired by you, I would encourage you to go at least name of the photographer / organization. This is also when people hire me to take photographs, how I agree with them. However, some organizations are pretty strict, and they only allow the organization's name to be used the attribution, not the photographer. So Mahesh, the answer is it depends on your agreement with the photographer.
Thanks. And Jerry has a follow-up questions based on the value of tagging. He asked, so there's no need to bother to tag on Flickr on YouTube, just as we stopped doing it for websites for the reasons Peter gave.
Yeah. Jerry, it's a she, actually.
I'm sorry.
Yes, tags are used less and less, so I would not encourage to spend your time on tagging pictures or videos on YouTube. This is used less and less in the search engines. I would not use this anymore. I would rather have you spend the time on giving a proper title, a proper description, a proper copyright notice for your pictures and for your video rather than tagging. Tagging becomes obsolete. You will see, but in here in a couple of years, tagging will no longer be used, because it's been so misused over the past years.
Thank you. That's new to me as well. My knowledge was obsolete, so that's very good. So people are happy about the response to the questions, so that you know. Another question, how does one register a copyright for his or her internet images?
Yeah, excellent question, Kabenga. For that, I would advise you to use Creative Commons. Creative Commons is a nonprofit organization who has worked out a legal formula for different combinations of copyrights. So the only thing we really now have to do is make a reference to that particular Creative Commons copyright notice, like you've seen in our example on the GFAR.net. So you don't have to work out the legal formula and the legal wording for your own copyright. So you go to creativecommons.org. I'll give you the link in the wrap-up document I will send after the webinar. And in there, you can find a different formula. Find a formula that works for you. Typically, it would be reuse is allowed under the condition of non-commercial use only and under the condition of attribution. And you use that formula in your copyright notice. This is also how you can do it on Flickr. So you don't have to find out or go to a lawyer to find your own legal language for a complete an exhaustive copyright notice. Use creativecommons.org.
Okay, this is the last question. So if anyone has another question, please do drop it on the chat box now. Mahesh is asking, is it an offense to use photos downloaded from the Facebook of someone if he has not given notice not to use as many are giving such notice in Facebook?
Yeah, in copyright, infringement and copyright risks, I am always rather safe than being sorry. On Facebook, you know, everybody shares whatever they can find. It's hardly ever you will find a copyright notice on Facebook. So I would be very hesitant to use pictures that I found on Facebook on my website. I would, you know, share them on Facebook, et cetera, which is within the Facebook legal terms. But I would not take pictures that I found on Facebook and reuse them on my website, unless, of course, I know the photographer and I have the explicit permission from the photographer. Very often also you will find that the pictures on Facebook are lower quality, so then they might not be particularly suitable for website. But stuff that you find on Twitter, on Pinterest, on social bookmarking sites, on Scoop.it, on Facebook, on LinkedIn, those pictures I would typically not use on my website or on my blog, because there is an overwhelming amount of pictures which are being published without giving the faintest having the faintest clue on copyright. Don't use it.
Great. I think we're done with the questions so far.
Okay. Shall we go to the next part, Marina?
Mm-hmm.
Let me just switch my windows here. All right. So we covered the chapter on finding pictures. Now before we go into how to process pictures, the pictures that we found, let's take just a sidestep. And let's have a look in how pictures are stored and displayed. Next one, Marina. So, yeah, that was right. Show me the one with the pixels. As you probably know, the smallest unit of information in a picture is a pixel. So each pixel in a digital picture is defined by the brightness of three basic colors. You can go to the next slide. It's going to come up. So the brightness of three basic colors, red, green, and blue. Thank you, Marina.
Sorry, it's bugging a bit.
No problem. So each of those three basic colors gets a value for web display between 0 and 255. Combining those values, 0 to 255, for each of the three basic colors, we can display a variation of about 16 million different colors. Good enough for the human eye to distinguish almost any color that we want. So this really ranges from a value of 000 for red, green, and blue, which basically means a display as black on a display, up to the values of 255, which means display everything as bright as possible as white. Now, because of the amount of information that we have in a picture, since the mid-90s, we're not using all of the original values for all of these pictures, pixels anymore. We started to use compressing schemes. And there are various picture compressing methods like GIF or PNG, PNG, or the most commonly used and the most popular one is JPEG, .jpg or .jpeg. Next one, Marina. JPEG compression scheme basically averages smaller areas in a picture and replaces the original value of each of those pixels, let's say an area of 16 by 16 pixels, with a value, an average value of that one particular picture. So this means it averages larger areas of a picture. So as you can imagine, the more you compress using JPEG, the harder you compress, the less detail you will have. So the flatter your picture will look like, but also how smaller the picture will be in byte size. So in the art of compressing using, for instance, JPEG compression, it is really all an art in finding a good balance between the byte size, the storage size of the picture, and its quality. Here in this example, if you have a good enough bandwidth, you will see a cat. On the right-hand side, we use no compression. On the left-hand side, we will use a very coarse compression. So you will see a gradation between the two as we compress more and more. So you can use JPEG with no compression, which means the original quality up to a very high compression. The more we compress, the smaller the byte size will be, the less storage it will take on your website to store, but also the faster the picture will display on your website. So this here, when we talk about processing pictures, is the eternal balance, the balance between quality and compression. Now, if you go to the next slide, Marina. Now, this brings us to the two basic parameters that we have to change or edit when we upload a picture, before we upload a picture on our website or a blog. First of all, is the physical size, which means the height and the width of n pixels of the picture. The second one is compression, and both are just as important, as both define how large the picture will be in size on your website, size of storage, and size in transmitting the picture itself to the browser of your user. And here is a secret of fast websites. Images are often what makes a website slow. It is easy to slow down a whole page or even a whole website just with that one bad picture. For instance, if in your website or your blog, you use a picture banner up on top that is displayed on every single page or blog post. Now, if you upload a picture of 2 megabytes, then all of your users for all of your pages or all of your blog posts will have to download that picture. And this is a mistake which you can do in 5 seconds. Just not think about compressing a picture or cropping it, and you upload it, you upload the 2 megabytes. This means that for all of your users for months or years to come, people will have to download that picture for every single page to see. And users hate slow websites. So in principle, slow websites are websites where the traffic is, the visitor traffic is low. And you can imagine that a lot of people, specifically in the area of work that we work in, are working with limited bandwidth. So very often it might mean that they can't even see the page. So my golden tip is, before you upload a picture, is to crop it to the dimensions, the height and the width you need it. So these will be the dimensions you will display the picture on your website. Once you have cropped it, reduce the physical size, pixel by pixel, height and width, to the size that you want it, then compress it before uploading to your website. And compressing them, remember, websites are typically have a low resolution, and the human eye is very forgiving for visual errors. So there is no need really for a picture of 400 by 600 pixels, for instance, to be uploaded in high resolution. Typically, 400 to 600 pixel pictures can be compressed to 50 or 100 kilobytes. And it's rarely that I come across a website or a blog that compresses its pictures well. So this means you really waste bandwidth of your users day by day. Now, here is a second golden tip, which is a common error many of us fall into. And listen really well to what I'm about to say. It is not because a picture is shown small on your website that this is the actual size, the storage size, in kilobytes or megabytes. It is a common misunderstanding. The storage size and the size the picture is displayed are two different things. And this is really, really important to understand. I can, for instance, upload a 3 megabyte picture file and have it display in the browser as a very small 50 by 50 pixel picture. Let's take an example. Say that I, at the bottom of my blog post, I upload the headshot of the author because I want to display it next as a small avatar at the bottom of the post next to his or her 5-line biography. I get from him or her a high resolution headshot of about, let's say, 5 megabytes. If I use this original picture and I upload that file to my website, and in my website editor, I reduce the size, the physical display size of the picture to display nicely next to that bio, in the end becoming only a 50 pixel by 50 pixel avatar, still, what the browser does when it displays that avatar, when displaying that page, is download the original size. So it will, for every time that page is displayed, it will download for every user, it will download a 5 megabyte picture in its original size. And then afterwards, look at your website data, your HTML code, and see, okay, how big do you want this to be displayed? 50 pixel, okay, I will resize it the moment I display it. So this means that the browser does different actions before showing a picture on your website. It will download the original picture. If you uploaded the 5 megabytes, it will download the whole 5 megabyte. Then it will look, where do you want this picture to be displayed? Okay, on the left-hand side. How big do you want it to be? You only want it to be 50 pixel by 50 pixel. Then the browser itself will resize it. And all of that happens while you are downloading the page as a user, when you view the page. So you can imagine that it is really a waste of storage space and bandwidth if, for that 50 pixel headshot of the author next to my bio, if each time people have to download a 5 megabyte picture. So it is really, really important that you trim, you crop the picture before you upload it to your website to the right height and width in pixels. And then you do a compression. So you reduce the resolution, because we almost never need the full resolution of a picture as it came from the camera. So compress it, combining quality versus storage size, of course, and always crop before you upload it. And next slide, Marina. One of where all of this trouble started from. Years ago, at the beginning of the website, of websites development, we all coded in HTML. So we knew exactly what we're doing. Now we've gone much more advanced, with the advantage that even editors or writers can now write a blog post, because now we have an editor like the one you see now on the screen. You have an editor like a WordPress editor. This is a WYSIWYG editor. What you see is what you get. Almost like an MS Word, you can play around with text, you can bold it, you can italic it, you can also play around with pictures, You can resize it in the editor itself. You can make it smaller. You can probably even turn it, et cetera, et cetera. But what people do not realize is even if you resize this picture in your WordPress or your Drupal editor, you only resize the display size, not the storage size. So my golden rule is I never ever change the display size after I've uploaded a picture. I always look in my layout of my website and my or my blog. I look at the size I will need, and then I crop and compress the picture before I upload it. Next one, next slide, Marina. So by the way, if you want to double check for yourself how big your pictures are that you have uploaded onto your website and or your blog, you can do so if you go to your website and you hover over a picture, you right click and you will see a drop down box and you will see something like view image info. The terminology depends a little bit browser by browser. If you click on that, you will see the details. Next slide, Marina. Here you see the details. By the way, you see the location, the URL. You see it as a JPEG image. The storage size is 38 kilobyte, and the actual dimension are 600 by 356 pixels. So that is actually the size, the physical size of the picture as it was uploaded. You will see in many websites, you will see an enormous size. It might be 1 megabyte, 2 megabyte, 3 megabyte, because people simply did not do the trouble, did not take the trouble of cropping and compressing the pictures before uploading. So keep that in mind. Crop and compress before you upload. In the next part, we will see, I will show a tool that I use to crop and to compress. Let's see, Marina, if we have any questions coming in.
Right. Let me have a look. Mary asks, does creativecommons.org also cover the IP of the content of a website as well, or just the images? Sorry, that's more for the part one, but maybe
yeah, that's fine. Let them come even for part one. It it covers all of the content, not just the pictures. Any content on your website.
Here again, it's also a question for part one. What's best practice for nonprofits for attribution to hired photographers? Strictly the organization or the photographer organization, strictly the organization or the photographer organization recommended by Peter?
Yeah.
Any pros or cons for either choice?
Well, it really depends on your agreement with the photographer, as I answered in the question from Mahesh. Typically, the more famous the photographers are, the more they will be insistent that their name has to be used as attribution. So the best practice is whatever is suitable for you. I would say minimum organization, but you can go photographer/organization. You know, it might also be publicity for you. If in your organization you hired a famous photographer, you know, then his or her name is used as a reference. But it really depends on your legal agreement with the photographer that does the project for you. Does he or she want his or her name as attribution, or allows you only to use the organization's name? But for the rest, there is no recommendation. It depends on the photographer. As you saw in my example, my agreement with CCAFS is that we both share the attribution, my name as well as the organization's name. Next, Marina.
And as a follow-up of this question, Vivian asks, I'm also interested in knowing how does one enforce copyright laws in the event of infringement, especially of photo attribution? What are the available remedies?
Yeah. You will see, but in my experience, people who are professional photographers and have an online repository, they do scan, or many of them do scan the web regularly with those reverse image searches as we just covered, and do look for pictures, where the pictures have been used, and if those people have followed their copyright descriptions or restrictions. That's how once I got a notification on my personal blog several years ago that I used a picture from somebody which was actually copyrighted. Now, as an organization, of course, you balance effort versus the reward. What I do from time to time, I know for myself which pictures I used a lot. So I do from time to time scan through Google search where those particular pictures are being used, and I have a quick look at attribution. And I would, if there's clearly a non-attribution, I would send them an email. Now, there are organizations who will take legal actions. So if indeed, as an organization, you have a very precious photo library that costs a lot of money for you to develop, and it's fully copyrighted, which means that people cannot reuse it without explicit agreement from your organization, which very often means you have to pay, then you might actually take legal suit. If not, just an email telling people, hey, listen, you have used the picture without proper attribution, please make correction, is already good enough. I've seen organizations who actually use interns, put them on a Google image search for most of their pictures during summer month, and having them send emails to the websites that did not follow the rules of attribution. Mm-hmm.
For those who joined us some minutes ago, don't worry, we would share the PowerPoint with you afterwards, so you won't miss a thing. And if you have any question for the part two of this presentation, please don't hesitate to drop your questions in the chat box on the right side of your screen. And I will move on with just one question, coming from me, actually. How do you actually compress the pictures, Peter?
Yeah, this is in the third part of the presentation. Marina, so also Daisy was asking, how do I compress the pictures with a Mac, which is in the last part of the presentation. If we move on, people can still continue to post questions and remarks and tips and comments in the chat box. We now go into the third part, which is we've seen now how to find pictures, and more importantly, how to make sure that we are okay with the copyright. We've seen a bit of the background on how pictures are stored and displayed. Remembering it is important to crop the picture to the right size that we want to use and to compress them. Now I would like to cover briefly a tool, the one and only tool that I use to process pictures. Next slide, Marina. Sorry, you're already there. So this is the Pacasa desktop. So I literally process, I would think, thousands of blog posts per year. For all of them, I only use one single tool, which combines simplicity with functionality, and on top of that, it's for free. Or I should say it was for free. It was Pacasa desktop. The only negative aspect is it was a Google tool. And since a few months, you can no longer download it from Google. But do not despair. I have a copy of the original tools before Google retired it, so you can download it for your use. It was freeware, so you never had to pay for it, so I'm not infringing any copyrights. So this is the only tool which for me works, that allows me to index all of the pictures on my hard disk into a library and easily crop, do basic processing, and compress them before I upload them to my website. So Marina, now we're gonna try, and if you stop sharing your desktop, because we won't have to go back again, and I see if I can share mine.
Sorry, okay.
Yep, and now I have to share mine. I don't seem to have the sharing icon. Help me here, Marina. I'm so happy.
The green icon?
Yeah. Got okay. it. Okay, let me have a look. Yeah. No worry if the screen is blurry or through your bandwidth, you will not be able to see it. This tool, present it to everybody. I will send you a link to a video where you can see how I use this tool. You see the tool now, Marina?
Yes, I do.
I think you. I still see your video. You might probably stop your video.
How do I? Are you sharing with the sharing presentation?
Yeah, I'm sharing and presenting to everyone.
And you show me on the as a big screen.
Yep, okay. But I see your video, so I don't know for the viewers if they actually see it.
Yeah. I don't think so, but I switched off my video just in case.
Yeah, I think we're on now. All right, very good. So this is the tool that I use. It's Picasa. This tool indexes all of the pictures I have in on my hard disk or the particular directories I wanted to index. So here I have probably 2,000 pictures in my library. If I want to use a particular picture on my website, the first thing I have to do is on my website, on my blog, I have to see what is the width and the height that I wanted to use. Say that I want to use this particular picture. Take a better example here. All right. Say that I want to use this particular picture. At the bottom, probably too small for you to see, I can see that the original picture is actually 3,000 by 2,000 pixels and it's 2 megabytes. So the common problem that we mentioned before would be I upload this original picture almost as it came from my camera and upload that to my website. And on my website, I would shrink the size to the size I actually wanted to use, which is typically a few hundred pixels by a few hundred pixels. So this is where we lose all of the bandwidth and all of the storage size. So the first thing I can do is to crop it, say that I only want to have a good headshot from this gentleman. I can crop it. Voila. Now I've cropped it. I can see here at the bottom what size it is. And then I can click on export. Export does two things. It resizes the picture to a certain amount of pixels, the width, and it compresses it. As you can probably see here, I can resize and enter the amount of pixels I want. For instance, if this picture on my website can only be 500 pixels wide, end at 500, and I can use different compression. I can use maximum quality, normal quality, or minimum quality. Typically for websites, minimum quality is good. So I choose minimum quality and I export. Now Picasa will process the picture and generate a new picture, which is this one, which is only 500 pixels wide. And you see what we've done. We've resized and compressed a picture, which was originally 2.1 megabytes. I don't know if you can read it here. It says it is only 30 kilobytes and is now 500 by 333 pixels. So instead of the user us uploading a 2.1 megabyte picture and every viewer of that blog post downloading a 2.1 megabyte picture, he or she will only have to download a 30 kilobyte. And this is how this works in this tool. So it is very simple. Let's take another example. We take this picture here. I can crop it if I want to have a more of a zoomed view of this particular young gentleman. I crop it to more or less the zoom what I want, and then I export it saying, for instance, if I only want to have this picture 300 pixels wide, minimum quality, I export it. And it creates a new picture with those particular dimensions that I have specified. The particular good thing from Picasa is that the way it compresses and the way that it crops pictures is done with very high quality. Very often I used photo editors, free photo editors, where if I want to reduce a picture to about half its size, it would throw away pixels. And that would make the picture very artificially edgy and raspy. Picasa is actually a tool that uses more a complex algorithm and shows a good quality picture, even if I compress it a lot and crop quite a bit. Again, this tool is no longer available from Google directly, so I'll give you two links where you can download it. Don't worry, it's a free shareware tool, So you're not infringing any copyrights. So this is Picasa. Now, apart from, of course, sizing it, what I can also do is some very, very basic color editing. So I can, you know, straighten the picture if the horizon is not really horizontal. I can rebalance the horizon. I can fill up light. I can increase the contrast. I can play with some colors. I can sharpen it. I can put some effects in it, etc., etc. These are very basic tools. This tool is not comparable to Photoshop and the features of Photoshop, but of course it's a free tool. I'm sure there are other tools available, but I am yet to find a tool which is so easy to use and really fulfills my needs, which are to have all of my pictures in one library and very easily in bulk even to process pictures and compress them. I'll stop my screen sharing. Marina, you can switch on your audio again and your video. Voila. And there we are back. Hey, we did as well, huh?
Yes. Chaotic beginning, but we're all good now. So you're ready for the questions from our audience, right?
Yeah.
So Mary did have a very nice question. It's related to the rights of those we take in picture. So taking example, the fact that, I mean, you have some people, communications people going in the field and taking pictures of farmers, for example. And Mary asked, do you have to get a release form signed for photos to get the rights or the authorization from the individuals, or is this just for videos? What's the general rule?
Yeah, as for many things, there is no general rule, and there has been quite a bit of discussions in the past. If, for instance, as a photographer, I go to a village and I take pictures of farmers, do I have to get a notice form of each of those individual farmers, knowing that those pictures might be used on a website? I've come across instances where the organization is insistent that indeed there is a release form signed by the people we take pictures from. In that particular case, we actually proven that it is practically impossible. You take pictures of, well, if I go to a village and I would do an interview and I would create a photo set, typically I would take 1,000 pictures. I would select probably 150 good quality of them. This means that in the end, the whole village has to sign. So this is not practical. What we typically do is when we go to the field and we do interviews, typically in farming communities and villages, is that we sit together with the village elder or with the village as a whole, and we explain what we do, why we do it, that this is used for what purpose this is used. And we also make sure that there is a way that we can feedback to the people that we have photographed, we can feedback the material very often, you know, through an extension agent. I would use that. It is practically really impossible to go in the field and make a photo reportage and have every single person you photograph sign. And typically also in the area that we worked, in the more rural areas, it's fine if you explain to people, we're going to take your photo, we're going to take your video, this is what we're going to use them for. But the moment you ask them to sign a piece of paper, that's when the real trouble starts. I would not do that. I would use it ethically though, making sure that people understand what it is used for, and having a way for them to get the end result of your efforts. That's how most of the organizations are doing it.
Go ahead. Yeah, I guess, yeah, legally we should stress that they do have the full rights on their image, and they have the right to disagree on having pictures taken from them, and yeah, that if they have any problem, they have the right to tell it and they have the final word.
Yeah, and this is also when before we start taking pictures, before we do anything, and you know, typically in rural areas, we would sit with the community and make sure that they understand. Some people don't like to be on a video, don't like to be on photos. Yes, do explain, they have the right to say no.
And Daisy is actually asking about, what about children's photos? Do we need clearance from their parents?
Again, I would do it within the community that we're photographing, and explain what we want to do. There are some ethical rules, though. Is that we use the pictures that we take from kids in an ethical manner. In the past, there's been quite a bit of a row in the ambulance chasing mentality, where, you know, when there's a hunger summer in Africa, that we show the pictures of starving kids and kids on children's beds, etc., etc. I would not suggest that we do that. Also, when we use pictures of children, I would make sure that this is not in a compromising situation. Again, when you work with the community, it's very important that the community knows what you do and agrees what you do. But it doesn't necessarily have to be signed. I think it's basically our own conscience and our own ethics.
Mm-hmm. Oops, sorry, it's going fast. Amy was asking how to assess the correct pixel size for use on your web page or blog.
Yeah, the pixel size is basically the horizontal physical size and the vertical size. So you basically measure on your website how big the picture is or the placeholder where you want to use it. For that, I actually use a plugin in my browser, and I can send you in the document I will send after the webinar, which I use. It's basically an online screen ruler that is overlaid on top of the website on the blog, where I measure what is the size, the height, and the width that I can use. So this is how I measure the pixel size that I want to use for my picture. So it's an online measuring tool.
That's great. Oh, your web developer as well can tell you. Vivian asks, in your experience in editing photographs using Picasa, is Picasa better than Lightroom and Photoshop? Are the related subscription costs of Lightroom and Photoshop worth it?
Yeah, no, Picasa is for free. It's always been shareware. Of course, you can do much more in Lightroom and in Photoshop. You have many more features. I mean, these are professional photo editing tools, but I've seen in most of the blog posts or websites that we actually work on that we don't need all of those features. We don't need the very sophisticated photo editing tools that we have. Again, from my end, I process over 1,000 blog posts per year. I don't write them, but at least I publish them. Picasa is the only tool that I use. So I am sure that it fits for 99.9% of the needs from the users. If you want to do more sophisticated photo editing to create photos, let's say to create photos for posters, etc., that's a different story. For there, you might need a higher resolution, be able to work on higher resolution a combination of pictures, do more sophisticated editing of pictures, retouching of pictures. Picasa cannot be used for that. If it is for web publishing, definitely.
Mm-hmm. And Daisy says, the preview on Mac is also good for basic crop size and compress. Maybe that's it for the Mac users.
Yeah. Although in general, I found the compressing tool to be more edgy. So if I compress a picture, reduce the size, they throw away pixels, so it becomes more edgy. Where in Picasa, it's a slight bit more smoother. But you could use this as a basic cropping tool. Yeah, sure.
Epiphane is giving another free software on the chat box. Not sure what this is.
Yeah. It's GIMP, GIMP.org. I can give that also. I have GIMP. I have two Mac tools that I use, Mac photo editing tools. I only use those for more sophisticated editing. Personally, actually, I found GIMP to be quite complex to use. It took me a while before I figured it out. But I'll include the two tools that I have, the one that Epiphan gave, GIMP, and I have another one. I forgot what it was, on the Mac.
Gbenga, or whatever is the pronunciation, sorry for missing. I should know, actually. So can Picasa be used to compress videos? If not, what would you suggest, since videos take more bandwidth than images?
Yeah. Well, of course, the easiest you can do is upload it to YouTube, and YouTube does a very good job in compressing. That's also why YouTube is very low quality, and people very often use Vimeo for high quality videos. No, because it cannot be used to compress videos. It can be used to make photo films, by the way. So you combine different photos and you put music on top and you create a photo video. It can also be used to view videos, but not to compress videos. I do not know what to use as video compression software. Maybe somebody in the audience would know, and you can add it in a chat box. The people that I know use either what is it again, the Mac tool for video editing, which in the export function has different compression schemes, or use professional video editing software.
Getting back to the right to the image or the format, etc. Daisy says, "I find it courteous to go back and give the village some print copies of good images. Is this okay?"
Yeah. Yeah. We've also done this when, again, in this trip for CCAPS, I took video, I wrote blog posts, I took pictures. So the extension agent that was with us went back again to the village and showed their slideshow with all of the pictures, gave them some hard copies, also showed the videos to the farmers, and showed them the printout of the blog post. That always goes well. I think what is important is that people get something back for the efforts that they do. I mean, if in the end they spend 1 day or 2 days with us for the interviews, be it video or blog post interviews or a photo reportage, I think it's good for us to give them something back. Very often, however, the challenge is how to get it back to the farmer. That's why I think it's a good idea to go with an extension agent that works with those farming communities, and they bring it back to the farming community. So yes, I agree with Daisy.
Mm-hmm. And actually Mahesh says, when farmers told about blog stories about them online, it makes them happy and they share it with many others, motivating them to do better farming. I experienced this recently.
Yeah, and maybe also give them a hard copy of of the blog post, for instance. Yes.
Nice. Going back to the videos and copyrights, what about the copywriting of videos? Is it the same as pictures?
Well, videos in on websites and on blogs very often are used in a different way. Typically, what people do is they download a picture and we upload it to their website, where most of the time videos are embedded. Typically, when people upload videos on YouTube, they can allow or disallow embeds. So if they allow embeds, this means they allow people to reuse the video as an embed video on other websites. Of course, out of courtesy, I would always give attribution to who made the video. Mm-hmm. So if they physically allow people to embed their video, then you can embed them on the website. I would not start downloading them with tools that exist from YouTube and re-uploading them onto your own YouTube channel, but embed them, yes.
And I guess it's good for any reference anyway that you use. I mean, you will always give the source, the author, and the original sites.
Yeah.
So it's a common rule to keep in mind.
Yes. And in videos also, we're of course only talking about videos, but it's always good to have a clear copyright statement on your YouTube channel, because there are tools that allow people to download videos. And for instance, they might use it at a booth in an exhibition, or they might actually use it as a snippet in their own videos and cut and paste it in there. So it is good to make sure that people understand whether they can or cannot use. Typically, people do not allow pieces of their video to be reused in other people's videos without explicit permission.
Mm-hmm. And Buggy asked, what about the property rights issue in the photo? How is it important? The metadata in the photos, for example.
Yeah. There is typically not a lot of metadata that we use in photos. that are important, I would think, and generally in the photos that we use for web publishing. You would have the camera type, you would have some people put the topic in there or put the caption in there. But typically people don't mind if that metadata is copied through. Very often also when you use other photo editing software, the metadata in the, for instance, the JPEG file would be emptied. Most of the time people store the metadata only for information, but not necessarily as valuable information in terms of IP rated information.
So you wouldn't inform all this before uploading the photos into the blog?
No. But I see that Boogie is also asking, okay, how important is it to edit the metadata prior to uploading the photos into the blog? Mm-hmm. I mean, if you have the technical means of editing the metadata, then you already go pretty sophisticated. So for the general information for the public is that the JPEG compression scheme not only stores the image itself, but it also has a header field where you can store certain data, like the type of camera it has been used. You can put a data field in there. You can even put a caption in the metadata, the date it was taken, the position, the geodata, the GPS position where the picture was taken. Personally, I don't do this. But what I do is when I upload a selection of my pictures onto Flickr, I would do the effort of editing the title and the description and eventually geotagging it. And that's about how far I would go.
Mm-hmm. And I assume all professional photographers do that, inform and document this kind of data. So it's very nice because when you receive pictures from professional photographer, you have all this information that they wish to have on the blog or on your Flickr accounts.
Yeah.
And
indeed also very often the caption or the full background information with the photo credit, very often they store in the picture itself as metadata, non-visible data. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's it in terms of questions. If you have any other questions, don't hesitate, it's not too late to drop them in the chat box.
Although it's almost too late because ding dong, it's 2:30. I have now as questions I need to cover in my wrap-up document. So I have the link to Creative Commons, which is the legal organization who created certain formula to copyright pictures or any digital data. I will send a link to a blog post I have written in how to use Picasa and how to compress and crop pictures with Picasa. I will upload the presentation so people can download the presentation if they want to go over it again, and the link to the recording of this webinar. I promised a link to Measure It, which is a plugin in my browser that I use to measure the physical height and width for a picture on my website. And I have the two Mac tools that I use in addition to Picasa to do more sophisticated editing. If anybody had any other good shareware video editing software, feel free to share them in the chat channel. That's what I had, Marina.
About the Picasa desktop? Do you have a link to...
Yeah, Picasa desktop. We'll send two links, one link for the Mac software and one link for the PC software.
And the link to the GIMP software?
I can also do that, yes. Yeah, I can do that.
Okay, sorry, there is another comment coming from Buggy. Watermarking in the photo is important also. Yeah. Sometimes I found it disturbing.
Yeah, so with watermarking, we mean putting certain text over the picture, or even at the bottom of the picture. I find that really disturbing. I certainly would not put, people also have the habit, very often when they submit pictures for a blog post, they would actually edit the picture and put the text of the caption in the picture itself. I would never do that. Of course, people do use watermarking to make the picture almost unusable. For instance, if I would be a professional photographer and I want people to reuse my pictures by buying them, then on my public website, I would put the pictures, I would put big watermarks over the whole picture to make it almost unreusable, but at least where people see the topic and the quality of the picture. But then put in the description that people have to contact me to get the original picture. Yes, but in generally, if you want to put your pictures out there for people to reuse it, I would not watermark them, no.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Edit them out anyway.
Maybe the very last question from Mahesh, should we insert photos in the blog write-up or submit them as attachments separately? How does it make a difference?
Yeah. When you submit a blog post to an editor or to somebody who publishes a blog post, it's always better to separate the pictures from the Word document itself. Simply because when you insert a photo into Word, the quality goes down. Very often people also manipulate the picture in the Word file itself, which again compromises the quality. And then we as editors, we have to save this picture from Word back again to original picture file and hope that the quality is still good enough to be able to reuse. So when you submit, and this is to magazines or other blog posts, it is important that in your Word file, you have your text only. You might include in your Word file, insert picture one here or insert picture with the title here, but do not insert the picture themselves. Add them as separate attachments to your email when you submit your blog post.
Mm-hmm. And the same applies when you try to copy paste from another website, because then the picture is dependent on the partner's website. So it means that if for some reason they put down the page, then your picture doesn't appear on your node anymore, right?
Yeah, that's right. So when you reuse a picture that you find somewhere else, I would always suggest that you download the picture and then you re-upload it to your website. Mm-hmm. There are people who have the unhealthy habit of what was the term again I used? Hot linking mm-hmm. pictures. What means hot linking pictures? Well, on my website, when I want to display a picture, I can either, after downloading, uploading it to my website. So then the picture physically resides on my website itself. But I can also hot link it, meaning that I insert in my blog or website a link from the original picture. So when my blog page is being displayed, it shows my text and then it shows the picture. For that picture, it actually gets the picture physically from the other website. Now, this is a bad practice. This hot linking is a bad practice. No matter if you hot link it from another website, if you hot link it from Flickr, simply because you don't have control over that picture. If they delete the page where you got the picture from, if they change the URL, if they replace this picture by another picture, then basically your blog or your web page loses its picture. So this is one reason. Secondly, if as the browser works, as it displays the page, it will take all of the elements and combine them into one page. So you can imagine if you have a blog page which has three different pictures, all hot linked to three different sites, then as the browser is uploading this page, it will have to take the pictures from these three different websites. Now, you do not control the speed of those websites. You do not control whether those websites are up or down. So very often, your page then becomes as slow as the slowest of all of the other websites you hot link on. And some people actually manage their websites really badly, where not even the pictures they use, but for instance, the icons that they use, for instance, the shareware icons or the social media icons, they hot link them. They don't upload them onto their website, but for each of those small graphic elements, they actually take them from another website or a repository. This is a really, really bad habit. And that can potentially make pages really, really slow. Do not hotlink. Download the graphic elements, download the pictures you want to use, and re-upload them onto your website.
Thank you, Peter. I think we're done. Everybody seems very happy with the quality of your response to their questions. So I think it's time to close and to follow up with the email with all the information that you mentioned earlier.
Very good. I would also appreciate, because this was a tryout with new webinar software, if people can email me some feedback, how they appreciated the quality, the physical quality, the video quality of this webinar software versus the previous one, BlueJeans, that we used, because we still are deciding what software we want to use. So thanks very much. You will get a follow-up email from me before the end of today. Thank you very much. Thank you, Marina, for your help.
You're welcome. Thanks. Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.